Hello, everybody. Good evening. Thank you all for coming here. I'm Linda. I'm one of the hosts tonight. I'm in upstate New York. Roberta is our other host. She's in downstate New York. It's great to see you all here.
Yes, great to see everybody. A lot of faces from last time too that we've
Yes,
seen before. Hi, everybody.
glad you're here. Addiction is a complex condition. It involves compulsive engagement in a behavior or substance use, despite negative consequences. It can be characterized by an inability to control the urge to engage in the behavior or consume the substance, leading to a cycle of craving, loss of control, and continued use. Addiction can affect anyone and can be related to substances like drugs and alcohol, or behaviors such as gambling, eating, or even technology use. It alters brain function, particularly in areas related to reward, motivation, and self-control. Overcoming addiction often requires a combination of medical treatment, therapy, and a connection to friends and family. Understanding addiction can help us to prevent it. So let's take a look at what experts say and let's discuss it all. Remember, here at Open Diner, we're trying to create a supportive environment where we connect above any differences. Please stay on topic, no criticism, avoid politics. Remember to mute your microphone when not speaking to minimize background noise. And if you can keep your cameras turned on, that would be great, which I see everybody does. That's wonderful. And please remember to keep your answers brief so that everyone gets a chance to speak.
Okay. Thank you, Linda. Hi, everybody. We have a nice full house tonight, which is wonderful. Great to see some new faces and faces that we've seen before. So it's a great topic tonight. We have three videos we're going to watch. We're looking forward to watch those. We could start out with an icebreaker. It's a simple question. I say simple, but we'll see how simple. The only thing we ask is that you speak briefly. And also, when you answer this question for the icebreaker, say your name and where you're from. So I'll start. This is how it's going to go. I'm Roberta from Long Island, New York. And the question I'm going to answer, and you guys are going to answer it too, is what is something you can't live without? What is something you can't live without? And the one thing I can't live without, obviously, I would say my phone or the internet, but I would say family and friends. That's something I really couldn't live without. If you ever put me on these islands like Survivor by yourself, I couldn't do it. I need family. So, whoever would like to continue, name where you're from and what can't you live without?
Susie from the rainforest of the Big Island of Hawaii, and I cannot live without all of you.
Thank you, Susie.
I'm Elisa from Brooklyn, New York. Roberta said it all, so I don't know what to add, but I will add that I don't think I ever survived anywhere where I wasn't close to the ocean or the sea. In addition, of course, to family and friends.
Also, like Eric,
I'll
go ahead.
go next. Hi, I'm Eric, and I come in from outside of Baltimore, and I literally cannot live without medication.
Thank you. Good to see you. Thank you for sharing that. Who else would like to go?
Hi, my name is Harry. I'm from Colonia, New Jersey, and I would say I can't live without my family.
Thank you, Carrie.
You.
See you.
That's pretty much what I would say, Carrie. I'm Linda, upstate New York. I can't live without my boys. I have four wonderful boys, and I absolutely could not live without them.
And Kathy, would you like to go next? Who's going to speak? I'm sorry.
I was going to talk again real quick because
Move.
everybody's talking about family. Some of us, you are our family. I mean, we've had either, too much abuse or something. So the family is the family of choice, and that's why I can't live without all of you.
Thank you, Susie.
Tomisha, I thought you wanted to say something.
My name is Tomisha, and I'm from Baltimore, and I can't live without traveling. I love to travel.
Nice. Thank you. Jessica, Kathy, Rano.
I'm Jessica. I'm from the Chicago suburbs, and I definitely could not live without my family or my friends.
Thank you. And then there were two. How about Kathy? Would you like to go next?
I'm Rono from Rotterdam, and I think can't live without my wife. She changed everything in my life.
Kathy, are you able to speak? I think there's no sound. Maybe if you come out and come back in, unless it's your mic, you show you're unmuted.
Hello?
Okay, good.
My name is Kathy, and I'm from Chicago, and I can't live without family either.
Thank you, Kathy. And I see Nancy just rejoined. Nancy, where are you from and what can't you live without?
Oh, boy. I am from a suburb of Chicago, and I can't live without my relationship with God. I can live without my computer, however, which dropped me.
Well, that's beautiful. I see Chicago's in the house tonight, right? It used to be a lot of New York, but okay, this is wonderful. All right, so I think everybody went, and they did, right? Wonderful. So we're going to watch a short clip. It's very short. It's a clip about the round table rules, because we're going to watch some videos tonight and do some workshops, and Rana's going to play it first. So let's just watch that, and then we'll go into the meat of the evening.
The rules of the round table. Around the table, no one is more important or less important. Everyone is equal and very important. We don't reject opinions or negate, but only collaborate. The real solution won't come from knowledge or verbal perfection, but only from our connection.
You're unmuted. You're muted, Linda.
Okay. We have a short video now. How addiction affects the brain. You ever wonder how addiction can affect the brain, how it works, how it handles things, how it makes you addicted? It affects children's brains even more. And here's a short video explaining it. Bruno?
Say the word addiction, and drugs such as alcohol, heroin, and cocaine often come to mind. But other substances like nicotine, marijuana, and prescription pain medications can also be addictive. So can certain activities such as gambling and sex. Whatever the case, addiction involves craving and a loss of control, with the substance use or activity continuing even if it causes harm. This can include problems with relationships, jobs, school, money, or your health. Addiction is not due to weakness or a lack of willpower. Instead, it's a chronic disease involving changes in the brain. There, billions of nerve cells or neurons communicate through a series of signals and chemical messengers. When messages leave one neuron, they attach to a receptor on the receiving one, like a key fitting into a lock. In addiction, this communication process is disrupted. Large amounts of a brain chemical called dopamine are released, overwhelming receptors and resulting in the high that people experience. To keep that feeling going, they take the drug or engage in the behavior again and again. Eventually, the brain changes and adapts, driving them to seek out more just to get the same feeling. That's called tolerance. Stopping a substance can cause withdrawal symptoms such as nausea, tremors, depression, or severe anxiety. Taking too much of a substance or a combination of substances can result in an overdose and serious illness, or even death. Young people are especially vulnerable to addiction. The impulse control center of their brains, known as the prefrontal cortex, isn't fully developed, making them more prone to risky behavior. And using substances can cause lasting harm to their developing brains. If you think your child might be experimenting with substances, talk to them about it. Parents can help by taking a strong stand against substance use and teaching their kids healthier ways to deal with life's stresses. Like any other disease, such as diabetes or asthma, addiction can be successfully treated.
All right. Well, now is there anything you knew that you didn't know about addiction before watching this clip? Or has this changed your perception of addiction?
Well, I can start because I really didn't know that it is not like my flaw or my weakness or something that I'm doing, you know, wrong, that apparently it's a mechanism that is, you know, you turn on and then it starts working and then it's very hard to stop it.
Anyone else? You all knew how addiction worked before this video?
I say a lot of those things, gambling, sex, drugs, food, it's like, that's like the core of a whole society. And that's, you know, when you put it in a line like that, it's like, geez, that's a lot of things out there, so especially for young children to deal with.
So, I've been an addiction counselor. I've had addictions. I've been the whole gambit. But the addictions under the physical addictions, like booze and all that stuff, are the emotional addictions. And they're like sadness or pain or something that we experience in our childhood. And I'm helping a couple of addicts right now here at the on the property. And they, you know, some of them have 5-6 addictions, and some of them like say, oh, I won't do this, but then it manifests into another one. And you really do have to find the cry in your spirit, in your heart. What is it that you're really looking for? Not the tobacco or the whatever they're reaching for. So, yeah, this is a great, great, great video. Great. Thank you, Roberta. Beautiful.
That's right. Even tobacco. Tobacco is highly addictive.
I think the in general, the scientific explanation is something that most people miss or don't know. You think of yourself as having bad habits or, you know, not enough self-control, things like that. You know, you see the little habits that that drives you and suddenly you see that you have to try again, or you want more of it, etc. But you don't know the mechanism behind it. Now, definitely, we learn a lot here.
I'll go real quick. I was a counselor for food addicts in one spot, and I did Overeaters Anonymous in an earlier part of my life, but. When you're teaching addicts that about food, they go to the fridge and they got to keep a diary, not just what is it you're eating, but what's the emotion behind it. Like, I'm frustrated, I'm angry. And then you get down to the addictions that we really need to take care of, and those are the emotional ones. Thank you.
Actually, you know, something new that, sorry, I learned that Susie reminded me, I just had a conversation with my friend whose son is actually, now I understand that it's not there is a pattern that you don't just stop after being addicted to something. Like her son is actually switching addictions. He was addicted to drugs. You know, he was addicted to smoking, then addicted to drinking, and now he's addicted to gambling. It's not like you just stop. You know, this is really, really quite a pattern, and it's explained in the video what we just saw.
Well, and some people actually have an addictive personality. Is it, there's actually a gene in certain people that is causes the addiction.
Well, I was thinking maybe Linda will go to another question. I was talking about what we about addiction and everything like that. There's a progression where we're going to go with this, friends. Don't just think we're talking about addiction all night like that. But let's maybe ask this question to you, girl, like you guys and girls. Have your parents ever discussed addiction to you as a child? Was that anything that was ever brought up? Because they were saying children have more of a chance of being addicted because the front cortical part of the brain is not developed. So I'll start. I was never discussed in my house, really. You're talking 50 years ago. But anybody, maybe Tamisha or Jessica, Eric, anybody want to answer that? Have your parents ever discussed addiction to you as a child?
No.
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 Like Nancy wants to unmute? No? Maybe not.
Your parents ever addicted to anything?
Probably.
I think that something that is always the case for most households is it's a difficult topic. My parents were not the kind to sit you down and teach you the facts of life, but they would show it by example. And I remember I had a very clear distinction of two men in my family, my dad compared to his brother, his younger brother. His brother was addicted to alcohol. And so every week you get a paycheck, and then that weekend you just become a different person completely. You know, just you can't talk or approach him. And I remember at one point we lived in the same house, and I had that, you know, just comparison of one and the other, and what kind of behavior is good and which one is bad. And they never said anything. You just realize how a negative impact it had on everyone, and you learn from there. I never said anything.
Well, you know, my parents were addicted to tobacco. Go ahead, Nancy.
No, I'm sorry. You finish.
I was just going to say they were addicted to tobacco, but then again, you know, 60 years ago, nobody knew how bad tobacco was.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think we knew too much about any of this 50, 60 years ago, about how any of it worked. And I think that now we're starting to learn, but I think part of the problem is that they think that it was thought for a long time that everything was by one gene, when in reality, it's a combination of different genes that will determine what is going to, like, I'm sorry, I'm explaining this badly, but I have ADHD, so I kind of studied this a little bit. And if you get so many of one gene, you can get an alcoholic. If you get so many of another, you get someone with ADD. If you get so many of another, they may have an anger issue. And it's all, I guess it's really all about emotionally, but it, like you say, it also affects the neurotransmitter. So, you know, I think it's a combination of all of them, but it is good to know if somebody, I have a friend whose mother was an alcoholic and her father was an alcoholic. So she warns her kids, she warned them at a very early age that it's in our family, so you must be careful. And I think that might help a lot.
I do that with my kids. because it runs in our family. Like my ex-husband was an alcoholic, and then my brother was an alcoholic. So I always warn my teenage sons, you know, if they're going to drink, just to be very, very careful. And you know, I'm not stupid. I know that they're definitely going to, you know what I mean? They're going to have a drink. I'm not against that, but I don't want them, you know, overindulging.
All right, well, we're going to watch another clip, and we're going to talk more about children, parents, and how environment affects, you know, addiction. So the video we're going to watch next is called The Great Strategy to Beat Addiction That No One Talks About. Before we watch the video, I just want to tell you about the creator of the video. His name is Dr. B, and he has a channel on YouTube. It's called Dr. B's Addiction Recovery. And he has a pretty good following there. So we're going to watch a little bit of his clip. And then we have some questions after that to hear what he says about it. He's a doctor and he went to UCLA also. So he has some experience on this. Let's watch this.
I said, Doc, what is one of the greatest ways that we can overcome the epidemic and reducing substance abuse in the future and so on? And this was an old addict. And the answer was really clear and easy for me. And it's cheap instead of where we're, our money goes. Invest in our children's mental health and their development. Well, I think that's one of our greatest resources for a better future, better world, a world that is more compassionate, more empathetic, smarter, and more educated than we are. And it can be done for pennies on the dollar by learning some basic issues about parenting, child development, the exposures they have. And we're chasing a dragon, a dream that's not there, forgetting our children and what they need. Hey, we had them. So you were old enough to have these kids. So now invest in them, take care of them for a better world in the future. That was my thought. Briefly, I can go on about this forever and have a 10-hour conversation with Pat Hall. That was my thought when someone's asked me, how do we prevent substance abuse moving forward in the future? Preventative medicine for our children. Go, Pat.
Yeah, no, I love that. So to be able to educate the future of this world, right, through ways that can increase compassion and empathy and just make more well-rounded human beings. So this is the X factor to that. There's a key to that. As the adult who is now tasked and responsible that if I want to make the future better for all of us, I need to go work on how I engage and interact with the children, which is the adults of tomorrow, then it's a good sign to say, okay, let me explore my own childhood first. Let me explore the parts of my life that I feel as a result of my own upbringing may have been negatively impacted, broken, harmed, that have caused me to have certain, you know, experiences in life. Once you get to that, that's where your work begins. And I'll tell you why that work's important. Because a person who is healed and whole and complete with themselves and their past and their present has a heck of a lot better chance to sit down with the future of this world and make some lasting impressions. So the beauty of what doctor said, in order to make the world a better place, we start with ourselves, we heal ourselves, and we take that version of self to the child. And it's not this, you don't have to be perfect because children have a transformative power. Children can create healing.
Get to that. Yeah.
Children can actually help heal a lot of past wounds through the firsthand experience with them because you go through it again and they're going to show you something, teach you something, say something, just even a look that they give you that's just going to be like, oh, you know, I'm right there with them. So don't underestimate the power that working with kids in a capacity that's, you know, that's bonding and builds trust and safety, how much it can have for your own inner child and the wounds from the past. And ultimately, you're healed.
So I was going to get to that, and he beat me to it. And I'll say the different way.
Say your word.
The opportunity to be there for your children in a positive way will create within that dynamic the child actually ending up doing more for you than you do for them, because they will, you know, impels you to mature, heal, deal with your own history, mental health, you will be much more fit physically, mentally, socially, economically, as you strive to create a child that is not going to be damaged from this world. So there's an irony here, right?
Okay. So that's a little perspective. Now we're going into another dynamic of this, right? The education of children and the parent speaking to the kids and actually healing ourselves in the whole midst of this. So we have a question for everybody to let's discuss together in a round table forum here. Anybody could speak. And I know I cut Jessica off before. I'm sorry about that. So if you'd like to go first, Jessica, you're more than welcome. If you'd like to answer it first. So the question is, and I'll put it in the chat, what kind of education can help children discover a positive purpose early? What kind of education can help children discover a positive purpose early?
Teach them about life's virtues.
Give them a lot of love.
What I heard is that we have to start from ourselves. And then we will be able to deliver what we want and teach kids and be a great example.
Alisa, we're right on again. I was going to say, the only way to teach is to be a good example. You know, kids don't want to hear us. You know, they want us, they, if they see something they're impressed with, they go, oh, I want to be like her. Okay.
Keep the lines of communication open.
Teach them mindfulness and how to process their feelings.
Well, we have some young friends here. You have Jessica, you have Tamisha. Maybe you guys could give us an example that maybe your parents or friends have taught you maybe in your life. I don't think you have children right now, but maybe you could look at that angle if you'd like to answer it that way. Something that you discovered from, you know, what kind of education you got to have a positive purpose. Just a thought, if you'd like to answer it, if you can't answer it from a perspective of a parent.
To not talk back to people, I mean to adults, to not talk back to adults, to always be respectful.
I have no idea what you just said.
How about you, Kathy? You can answer maybe if you'd like. What kind of education can help children discover a positive purpose early?
Not sure. I'm struggling with it myself.
It's okay. Thank you for sharing. We learn as we go here, right?
I think that, you know,
sorry about that.
Nancy, go ahead.
I'm sorry. Boy, I seem to keep doing this wrong tonight. I was just going to say that it would be nice. First of all, parents gotta stop judging their kids. Like, I mean, I know they can't just accept everything they do and say it's all great, but there has to be a way to not make kids feel bad and not want to come to you. That's how I grew up. I grew up in a very, very judgmental home. And I know my mom didn't mean to, but you know, that's how it comes out. That's the first thing, because you know, you're not gonna go to somebody if you feel like they're gonna judge you for what you say. The second is, I think they could maybe give a perspective to kids. Like, you know, when you're a child or when you're young, you don't really think about tomorrow or next year or 5 years from now. And maybe it would be good if we were reminded, like in high school, it is so important to fit in with that group. And that is right here and right now. And maybe it would be nice or helpful in some way if we're reminded that, You know, 4 years is like the blink of an eye in your life. And fitting into this group right now isn't going to matter later. And I mean, I'm saying it very poorly, but maybe just some kind of perspective so that kids don't think the be all and end all is right here, right now, and what we do now to fit in instead of considering consequences later.
Rona, I think you want to go, but I just want to say that I'm so impressed. Like, this is the, you know, Kathy and Nancy are such an example. Like, what is so important, like Kathy just said, I'm not sure. You know, parents are rarely, they have to know everything. They have to be on top of everything, you know. But being honest and being saying, I really don't know, you know, and look at the kid that you don't want to make the kid your mirror. You see what is unique in the kid, and then grow from there, you know, and grow together. Like actually, we just heard together that kids can teach us maybe more than we can teach them.
Give them positive reinforcement instead of telling them what they're doing wrong. Focus on what they're doing right. And like I said before, keeping the lines of communication open, letting your kids know that they can talk to you about anything without judgment.
I think one thing that we should give them is the overview. You know, it takes a lot of experience to be able to step back and look at life in a, you know, in a general way, instead of just the focus on your own little square, because that way you can avoid the pitfall of what everyone is doing and being, you know, like sucked into a negative environment where what is going to help, you know, is to understand what is what life requires of us. You know, where you find this actual happiness. Right now, the world is showing us that we have to have stuff, we have to have better stuff, we have to have new stuff. And the stuff you have now, it's not going to be good tomorrow, because tomorrow there's another stuff that's coming out and you need to get it and throw away the one you have. And you create a lot of waste. And we keep chasing things that actually, other than the exact moment you get it, does not give us any kind of satisfaction. Because we need another one. That's where addiction comes from it. So, you know, if especially we're talking about kids, it also applies to anyone that you can help by giving them an example. Because that way realize that, you know, this, you know, consumer society is not bringing us happiness, and something is missing, and where is it?
It's like the question says, what kind of education? I think it's the maybe worded a little wrong. I shouldn't say wrong. We're the ones that wrote the thing, but what kind of example maybe can help children discover a positive purpose, like you're saying, Rano, you know? Not so much education. I mean, that could be something we're going to discuss actually in the next question, but let's finish this question. If anybody wants to add, what kind of a example can we have help children discover a positive purpose early?
Just volunteering, being part of your community.
Yeah, because education is not like a formal schooling only. Education is just everything you observe from the environment, from where you are. You know, you just suck in everything, you know, even more. I remember, you know, it was many, many, many years ago that was just one of the psychologists. She won some prize, you know, began shocked everyone by saying, oh, parents, you can relax because your kids are actually learning more from their peers than they're learning from you. You know, and that is actually when they grow up, that's basically, you know, what's happening.
Yeah, you said about volunteering. I'll just say my nephew, my sister did a great job raising her children. She had them, not had them, she showed them and they wanted to do it volunteering, like Eric said. And to this day, I really believe it gave them such an up in life because they realize that, you know, there's people that are in need and they're very, you know, good kids, very observant of when someone needs help. And they bring it over, they're in their 20s now. And I could see that was a very good positive thing that she showed them is to help others, not worry about yourself and run with the right crowd, even though, you know, like I think someone said here, but, you know, sometimes the crazy cool people, the people doing all the bad stuff. And in the end, I could, as an older person, I could look back, if I had kids, I'd say, if you knew where these people are today, you'd say, no good. So to show by example and, you know, make it something fun that they want to do.
Well, Jimmy Buffett saying, we are the ones our parents warned us about.
That's true.
Yeah, he also sung Cheeseburger in Paradise.
What do you think, Linda? Should we do another question?
Well, I mean, I think we pretty much did. Well, do you think it should be part of the educational system? Should education in school? Yes. All right. Or should it be both? Should it be education system and home? Is that what everybody thinks?
Ideally, that would be the case. I, you know, it would be nice in a perfect world. I just don't know how much. I get the sense today, and I could very well be wrong, but I get the sense that parents don't pay as much attention to their kids. And maybe it's the same as it was when I was a kid. Maybe it just, I'm just noticing it because I'm an adult now, sort of. excuse me. But I think it would have been great if they started all these activities that are supposed to teach us at younger ages, volunteering, classes that would help kids learn their aptitudes and also their interests. Sometimes it's really hard. Someone says, what are you interested in? Well, I don't know, girls or boys or football. I mean, you have to help them to develop some ideas. Maybe they don't know what's out there in the world that they might want to do. And I don't mean just as a vocation, but also as an avocation, you know? Music, instruments, if you don't help them to learn and become familiar with what they could do, how are they going to know? I would have liked that when I was young. I didn't get anything like that. I went away to college still not really knowing. And I actually went to a junior college when I got out of school. I had a degree by then. And I made them let me take interest courses and aptitude so that I could figure out where I was supposed to go. That should be done a lot younger than it was for me.
You know, it's interesting that there are no schools that gives you parenting classes in the educational system, and teaching kids is one of the most important things that you will ever do in your life. And why is that? Like, something in like at least 2 hours in college every week or in high school, come on. People have kids when they're 16 sometimes. And the basics of, you know, raising kids and taking care of them isn't something that we figure out as we go along. And that's kind of scary if you think about it.
Well, Rono, now you're talking about sex education. Teach them not to have children that young.
well, even social skills. I think it was home economics my mom used to take. Now, she's in their 80s, but they used to teach how to cook, put a stamp, write a letter. They don't even write script now in school anymore, which I'm shocked. But not only that way, doing stuff around the house, but even interacting. I don't know if they have in schools today. Maybe the younger friends here could maybe expand on this. Maybe you would know. Do they have it, like, if you have an issue, do they have, like, places that you go and talk around with groups? Do they have activities like that? That's what's really needed, to have social skills, social. Because most people today don't have any social skills. I'm probably just as bad at times. You know, if you're standing next to somebody, you don't even speak to them. Do they even have that? That's something that's really important. Interaction with people, that you can express yourself. What do you guys think?
And a little self-esteem.
What do you think, Jessica? You guys are quiet. Kathy? Tamisha?
I think in the schools right now, now, they don't have these kind of things for kids unless there's a problem. So rather than wait till there is a problem, you know, maybe, you know, help them get things out so they won't have this problem. You know, I don't know. I think maybe we're expecting too much out of the school system.
Maybe you're right. Jessica, go ahead.
Well, I think that both can be equally important when it comes to helping kids develop eventual rounded people. Well, like, social skills can be taught in built environments. I also think that they can use creativity as a way of self-expression, like writing or music or art.
It's too bad they're doing away with a lot of those programs. You know, they don't think they're important for kids' education. The writing, the music, the sports, all that stuff. They home ec, they did away with it. I that's one of the problems.
Well, maybe we'll go to the next video, Linda. It talks, you'll introduce that one. I think that leads us into the next dimension of this conversation and the solution, hopefully.
Yeah, here's an interesting short video on a recent study about addiction involving rats.
Almost everything you know about addiction is wrong. You get a rat and you put it in a cage and you give it two water bottles. One is just water and the other is water laced with either heroin or cocaine. The rat will almost always prefer the drugged water and almost always kill itself quite quickly. So there you go, that's how we think it works. We're putting the rat in an empty cage. It's got nothing to do except use these drugs. Let's try something a bit different. So Professor Alexander built a cage that he called Rat Park. Basically, heaven for rats. They've got loads of coloured balls, they've got loads of tunnels. Crucially, they've got loads of friends, and they've got both the water bottles, the normal water and the drugged water. But here's the fascinating thing. In Rat Park, they don't like the drugged water. You go from almost 100% overdose when they're isolated to 0% overdose when they have happy and connected lives. Because the opposite of addiction is not sobriety. The opposite of addiction is connection.
Wow. So do you think we could have a society where isolation is not possible, where we encourage communication?
Well, I definitely hope so. That is, it sounds like a cure, absolutely. And, you know, it sounds like a possibility for us to find a solution, you know. And when we know that when we're surrounded with people whom we can share, who we like, who we share, you know, and we can be open, and, you know, and they can be open. And like most of you, you know, mentioned judgment, that there are no judgment around us. And there is a lot of people like, you know, then there is no need for extra, you know, push or you know, something. Because isolation is a main, I think, it is a main cause of addictions.
We didn't show that same video last time, did we? You didn't show that video with the rats the last time, did you?
I think we did.
I remember I had just seen it, but I didn't know if it was in this group or it was in another group.
It was part of it.
Yeah.
Pieces of it, yes. We did use it. It's a good video.
Okay.
Yeah, it just proves the fact that being isolated will cause addiction, because you need something to fill your time, but not just being in a society of a group of people, but being in a good society. You know, you could be have a lot of friends and they're all bad people and they're all drug addicts, and then you're going to be a drug addict too. But I think we can build a society. I don't know. What do you think?
I think, I saw a statistic that 47% of the people live by themselves. So that's not going to help that situation. And I have no idea how to fix that.
Well, years ago, the family used to live together. It was like, you know, three generations in one house.
Right.
They did away with that. Everybody wants to be on their own now. And what do you think makes that connection a key to a good society?
I think that the key that's very important is to understand how much we depend on each other. You know, I remember the COVID, the beginning of COVID showed us how much an impact each person had on the environment. Suddenly when the lockdown happened and people were, you know, journaling month by month, how much the environment was improving because humans were not around to mess it up. The air was clearing and you could see far off, you know, there was less fog and et cetera, et cetera. We understand that every decision that you make impacts everyone else around you and even around the globe that people you never meet. So we understand that this isolation is a disease, but because people need each other in order to build a society that is balanced and everything, and you know, for them to find happiness in it. And just the fact that someone is suffering means that he has to have an environment around him to hold him up. If there isn't, then how is it going to get better?
And diversity, I'd say. I mean, you look at us all here, we're from different places all over the world, actually. Rano's in Holland over there, and we have friends in Chicago, all over the place, New York. And what makes a good society, I think, is everybody accepting everybody else as they are without judgment. And I think that's why people get isolated, because they feel they're being judged. And I don't want to be around, I end up being, let's say, by myself, because I'm not like others, if you want to say. But a good society is to have people that you could talk to, and really rely on. That's something that is built. Society sounds like, I'm thinking like a society, like the whole New York, but a society could be just a group of friends. More than one is really a group, a couple of people, and you start building from there. I think it's very possible. We probably have very good friends in our life, hopefully, that at least you could talk to one person. And if like-minded people have the same goal, eventually maybe more people would add to it. But the key to it is acceptance, I feel, without judgment. And like we start with ourselves, don't judge others, you know?
Yeah,
it's too bad that it doesn't.
No, I was just going to say, I would just add, you know, being open-minded and have an empathy for each other as well.
Nancy? I know you would.
I was going to say, it's too bad that we can't start that kind of thing with younger, when we're younger. Like, kids start judging each other in what grade? Seventh, sixth, seventh grade, something like that, where they start separating off into those, that group does this and that group does that. And it's too bad that there can't be a way to fix that sooner, like start teaching people to be less isolated and be more friendly sooner. I'm not sure if that's what I was going to say, but that's what I came up with.
And don't be a bully.
What I want to say is that I think we have to start with ourselves, you know, because I can speak about myself, you know, you can hear my accent. I came from former Soviet Union many, many years ago, but it doesn't matter. And back at home, I always remember we were in crowded buses, trolley buses, you know, in all kind of public transportation, like jammed together. And now, if after so many years, you know, if somebody on a subway touches my bag, I am almost furious, you know, and I'm looking at myself and thinking, what's happened, you know, and this is, we have to be aware, I have to be aware of how my ego is growing, you know, it's growing exponentially. And that is what creates this bubble around me, you know, that this doesn't fit, this doesn't fit, this doesn't fit, you know, and this is creates this isolation. I think I have to look at myself and see how can I break through this bubble. I'm not saying that we should be in crowded buses and trolley buses. I'm not inviting you there, but we have to get somehow closer, more open to each other, you know, and start with us, with adults, and kids will follow, you know.
You know, also say the internet, look at us here on Open Dining. We've been meeting now for 4 years or more, and people come, we talk, we discuss, no one's judging everybody. You see how we do the round table workshop. I mean, this is a society in itself, like Susie said before. And, you know, we expand out from what we're learning here and we take a little bit from it. And I know I do, and do it with people that I just meet and friends and family. So we learn from example. There's always a place where you guys could go and find a group that, you know, clicks with you, something that you know, instead of going to an addiction, there's groups out there. That's the beauty of the internet today. It's one of the uses. Anybody else like to add? But any good societies that what comes out of it, like what you learn from a good society that you would actually take? Let's do this. I know these are questions that you're going to think maybe an hour from now, like, geez, I could have said that. I usually say that, but maybe we could give some impressions. What do you think, Linda, of tonight? Like, what is something that we've learned or taken away? Like I was just saying, I would take away from, you know, being more open-minded and not so judgmental of people. That's what I would take away by these connections we're talking about, good societies. But maybe let's do a round. Everybody could talk briefly. What you take away from this evening tonight in Open Diner? if anything, hopefully something you'd like to share.
Eric, let's pick on someone. Eric, what'd you take away from this?
Well, I've gone to a lot of meetups, and this is one of the better ones where we can have a nice discussion on several different topics. But I'm involved with a lot of the meetups that I'm purposely going to, so that I can do the things that make me a better person, and it'll rub off hopefully on the next person, and try and pass it, pay it forward, as they say.
Kathy, what'd you take from this?
That the opposite of addiction is not sobriety, it is connection.
Very good. Tamisha?
That addiction is, well, not so bad and good at the same time, but I really don't know. And about isolation, it to like be open, like to having like more friends or whatever. I really don't know. I apologize.
Don't apologize.
I think you just said to have more friends. This
yes.
Is
to have this more is, friends.
You do
to,
know.
To be open.
I'm with you, yes. Tanisha. I'm single. Send help, please.
I think we'll see, bud.
Have a carry. You have a delay over there. Well, do Carrie, then Nancy. How's that? Go ahead, if you'd like to add.
I would say, just from being a good person and being a good example, that that we can teach ourselves and our children a lot of things, just by, being mindful and trying to help them process their feelings, and so things do not turn into addiction. So.
Right. I would go along with that for sure. We know right off that any kind of isolation is going to cause some kind of mental health problem. And very often there are what they call the dual diagnosis, which is mental health and an addiction, because people try to figure, people try to figure out how to deal with their problems, and they use drugs instead of doing it the right way, right? So we know right off that that's bad. I'm thinking that the earlier we can start to realize that getting people to be friendly with each other so that people can feel like they can share openly is our best bet. The younger the age, the better. But that doesn't mean that we at this age or right out of college or middle age can also use that same thing, just to be like this group. Like you said, I love this group for that very reason, is that we can talk about things that, you just don't normally talk about with your friends or family outside of here. And it would be nice if there was more like this out there.
Jessica? Yeah, the last one. What did you get out of this?
Well,
that's okay if you're not sure.
Yeah.
Right? I'm going to put pressure on you.
Yeah, maybe I'm not really sure right now.
Not a problem. It's great you're here. That's the main thing. That's what we got out of this, is you being here. So like we were saying, we ran out of time. We're actually over time. But one thing I have to say, which Kathy picked it up, and I had a little bit of conclusion to add before we left. But you guys said it all. That's what the impressions were, our real conclusion. But what Kathy said, I actually put on the side to say at the end, as we saw in the video in Rat Park, the opposite of addiction is not sobriety. The opposite of addiction is connection. And you picked that up, Kathy. And Eric, remember the video from last time. So we're so thankful everybody joined tonight. You guys make this evening what it is. And as some reminders to keep in touch with us at Open Diner. You can join us on our meetup group. You could follow us on Facebook. We also post on Instagram and Nextdoor, Twitter, and Pinterest. If you prefer, you could subscribe to our email list for a bi-weekly notification about our events. Your email is never shared with a third party, only a fourth party. I'm kidding, making a joke. Some of our old events are on YouTube. If you want to watch it and share with your friends, that would be great. We invite your friends to join us. More is always better for the conversation. Links will be in the chat. And again, thank you for coming, everybody. We'll see you, if you're going to join us, hopefully you will, in 3 weeks, not two, three. And our next topic in 3 weeks will be on September 26th, the happiness muscle. You can leave off whatever you want to think about that, but the happiness muscle. And until we meet again, we'll expand our connection, and we hope to see you again. Thank you, everybody. This was an enjoyable night. Learned a lot from everybody's perspective. So we'll leave with some music. And I think it's fitting for this evening. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks for
everyone. Thanks,
everybody.